Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And blessed be God's kingdom, now and forever. Amen. Jesus said, "The first commandment is this: love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. The second is this: love your neighbor as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than these." Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Grant, O merciful God, that your church, being gathered together in unity by your Holy Spirit, may show forth your power among all peoples to the glory of your name, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Please be seated.
A reading from Isaiah. Then you will call, and the Lord will answer. You will cry for help, and God will say, "I'm here." If you remove the yoke from among you, the finger pointing, the wicked speech, if you open your heart, those who are hungry, and provide abundantly for those who are afflicted, your light will shine in the darkness, and your gloom will be like the noon. The Lord will guide you continually and provide for you, even in parched places. He will rescue your bones. You will be like a watered garden, like a spring of water that won't run dry. They will rebuild ancient ruins on your account. The foundations of generations past you will restore. You will be called mender of broken walls, restorer of livable streets. If you stop trampling the Sabbath, stop doing whatever you want on my holy day, and consider the Sabbath a delight, sacred to the Lord, honored, and honor it instead of doing things your way, seeking what you want, and doing business as usual, then you will take delight in the Lord. I will let you ride on the heights of the earth. I will sustain you with the heritage of your ancestor, Jacob. The mouth of the Lord has spoken. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The psalm for this morning is Psalm 103, verses 1 to 8. Bless the Lord, O my soul.
And all that is within me, bless his holy name.
Bless the Lord, O my soul.
And forget not all his benefits.
He forgives all your sins.
And heals all your infirmities.
He redeems your life from the grave.
And grounds you with mercy and loving kindness.
He satisfies you with good things. The Lord executes righteousness
and judgment for all who are oppressed.
He made his ways known to Moses
and his works to the children of Israel.
The Lord is full of compassion and mercy,
slow to anger, and of great kindness.
A reading from the letter to the Hebrews. You have not drawn near to something that can be touched, a burning fire, darkness, shadows, a whirlwind, a blast of a trumpet, and a sound of words that made the ones who heard it beg that there wouldn't be one more word. They couldn't stand the command. If even a wild animal touches the mountain, it must be stoned. The sight was so frightening that Moses said, "I am terrified and shaking." But you have drawn near to Mount Zion, the the city of the living God, heavenly Jerusalem, to countless angels in a festival gathering, to the assembly of God's firstborn children who are registered in heaven, to God, the judge of all, to the spirits of the righteous who have been made perfect, to Jesus, the mediator of the new covenant, and to the sprinkled blood that speaks better than Abel's blood. See to it that you don't resist the one who is speaking. If the people didn't escape when they refused to listen to the one who warned them on earth, how will we escape if we reject the one who is warning from heaven? His voice shook the earth then, but now he has made a promise. Still, once more, I will shake not only the earth, but heaven also. The words, still once more, reveal the removal of what is shaken, the things that are part of this creation, so that what isn't shaken will remain. Therefore, since we are receiving a kingdom that can't be shaken, let's continue to express our gratitude. With this gratitude, let's serve in a way that is pleasing to God with respect and awe, because our God really is a consuming fire. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Luke.
Glory to you, Christ.
Jesus was teaching in one of the synagogues on the Sabbath, and just then there appeared a woman with a spirit that had crippled her for 18 years. She was bent over and was quite unable to stand up straight. When Jesus saw her, he called her over and said, "Woman, you are set free from your ailment." When he laid his hands on her, immediately she stood up straight and began praising God. But the leader of the synagogue, indignant because Jesus had cured on the Sabbath, kept saying to the crowd, "There are 6 days on which work ought to be done. Come on those days and be cured, and not on the Sabbath day." But the Lord answered him and said, "You hypocrites, does not each of you on the Sabbath untie his ox or his donkey from the manger and lead it away to give it water? And ought not the woman, a daughter of Abraham, whom Satan bound for 18 long years, be set free from this bondage on the Sabbath day?" When he said this, all his opponents were put to shame, and the entire crowd was rejoicing at all the wonderful things that he was doing. The gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ. Alleluia, alleluia, give praise to you.
words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart to be always acceptable to you. O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. Amen. Please be seated. Several of you have sent this cartoon to me, so I know some of you have seen it. So those that haven't, imagine this. There are a cartoon of three donkeys, and it is the first century, and there are three women sitting on each side of the donkey, and you're looking at the back end of the donkey. And on the first one, there's a bumper sticker. Now, it's funny enough to think of a bumper sticker on a donkey back in the first century. I find that funny. So the first one, the bumper sticker says, "My son is an attorney." And then the middle donkey, the bumper sticker says, "My son is a doctor." And then the third donkey, the bumper sticker says, "My son is God." It's Mary. Okay, so it's Mary sitting on. Do I need to start with the divinity of Jesus, and then we'll go from there? So, all right. You know, this is much better. I know, they all don't work, yes. And it's much better than the other joke. Do you want to hear the other one? It's even worse. David, okay, here we go. Moses is negotiating with God up on the mountain, and he comes down. It's the third time he's come down. And he looks at the Israelites, they rush towards him, and he says, "Well, I have some good news, and I have some bad news. The good news is, I got the Lord down to 10. See, that's the punchline. I'll just end there. You don't want to hear so. Well, then what's the bad news? He still doesn't want you to covet anything. Oh. See, Alleluia. We'll just start over again, right? Just take two. We'll edit this out. All right. So commandment number 10, thou shalt not covet anything that your neighbor owns. It's the last one. I know. It's just one of those really weird church jokes. Okay. So I'm being told it's funnier this way. So the good news is I got him down to 10. The bad news, adultery's in it. Okay. See, that doesn't work either. The bad news, you can't lie. Oh, see, there is no, all right. I'll keep, next week, we'll try this again. So, there's a donkey, and there's a bumper sticker on it. It goes through. It's the idea that Mary had a son, and his son is the whole idea, the incarnation of God. And so, imagine this. What would the envy of the other mothers around Mary, what would it be like? Did they treat her with respect and awe? Did they treat her with disdain? Did they shun her? I really wonder. I wonder about what that is. And I have been wondering a lot about envy. I've been wondering about it because on Tuesday this past week, I was at the American Jewish Council luncheon on stamping down anti-Semitism in our area. I know it's heavy. And I'm going to talk to you a lot more about what was discussed, what is coming out of it, the coalition of Christian churches in Sarasota and surrounding areas, and our response to it. But there are two things that have struck me from this that I want to share with you. And the first one is that anti-Semitism is anti-Jewish, but it's also anti a lot of other things. And specifically, the speaker who was the national speaker on anti-Semitism, she was telling us that if the anti-Semites win, and if the Jewish people go underground and more or less are not seen anywhere, anti-Semites will go after the church. They will go after liturgical churches first. They'll go after the liturgical churches that find their doors wide open to all who are called to God's love. That's next. And then they will go after people of different skin tone. They will go after people of different genders. That's what they do. And so anti-Semitism is a problem for all Americans and for all faithful people. So that was number one. Number two is, that surprised me, is that anti-Semitism is not based on hate. It is based on envy. It's based on covetousness. It's based on wanting something else that somebody has. It is envy that then moves itself into hate, which then moves itself into a physical property. But it all starts with envy. Envy is, again, the 10th of the commandments. It's the last, number 10 of the 10 commandments. We often, people of faith, often get focused on the big ones. I am the Lord your God, you will have no other God but me. You will not take my name in vain. You will take one day, you will worship me on that day. You know, we focus on that. You won't kill, you'll be honored and faithful in all your relationships. We think of those. But then we get down to coveting, the last one. And it is said that envy, or covetousness, that envy has bonds that are so weak that eventually you'll get so many they cannot be broken. Remember Gulliver's Travels? Remember Gulliver? Okay, Jonathan Swift, Anglican priest. I don't know if you knew that. Also a writer. He writes about things that have ethics and backgrounds to them. So imagine Gulliver, and you imagine that he went to Lilliput, and at one point he created a great amount of envy within the people, so much so that they bound him and they wanted to blind him. And so Reverend Swift is writing in there about what envy can do and how it can be unchecked, make you want to blind others the way that you have been blinded by envy. So when he's on the ground and they start throwing lines over him to hold him down, because they're only 6 inches tall, these lines are like thread to us. And so 3 of them, 5 of them, he could easily break them. 20, 30, he could dislodge those. 100, 500, 800 across him. Suddenly, it's so strong, it can't be broken. So says Reverend Swift, is the way that envy works on our heart. It is so light to be felt, you don't know it's there until it's too hard to be broken. Envy. In grief counseling, for those that have gone or going through divorce, for widows, widowers, grief counseling says you're at some point you will have to deal with envy. You will have to deal with the fact that other people are married and that your loved one is gone. You're going to have to deal with the fact that other people around you have spouses or partners that they treat with very little accord and very little love and just with a passing thought, where your loved one was the most precious and most powerful and important person in your life and they're gone. You're going to have to learn how to deal with envy. I have a friend, her name is Teddy. She and her husband Richard were in Ireland on a vacation when their son in his 20s was playing basketball and died of a heart attack. Her grief counselor said, you're going to have to deal with envy. You're going to have to deal with every other parent you know whose son is still alive. And she thought she had it under check, and then one day she was at Walmart, and this is in South San Diego. She was at Walmart, and she saw a mother berating her young son up one side, down the other, and she was worried it was going to turn physical. Teddy went to confront the woman, and then she felt the presence of the Lord on her shoulder and said, you continue this line of thinking, you're leaving here in handcuffs, lady. She knew that the envy that she had built up for other mothers that still have their sons would have been explosive. And so Teddy has told me she has had to deal with the invisible lines of envy. She's had to deal with that. So there's a story I told in one of our Bible studies, and I'll tell it to you all now. I was in seminary. I was studying, and I think it was at a coffee shop. I was somewhere outdoors. And next door was a Wells Fargo. And something caught my attention, and what it was a convertible Porsche Boxster Do you guys know a Boxster? Have you seen the convertible? Well, just imagine a convertible Porsche. All right, brand new, doesn't even have California plates on it. It's so new. And the guy drives in, he parks, and he's in his tan slacks and a blue shirt. He's looking all happy. He closed the door, and he shut the door with two hands. Ever seen guys do that? Like, you know, I've seen Corvette owners do this, right? You know, they just close it. He just stood there, admired it, and he got the key out, and burp, burp, you know, he clicked it. And he walked into Wells Fargo, and I was admiring his convertible Porsche as well. It's a beautiful car. And then I got back to my studies, and then I heard a low rumbling engine sound. And that engine sounded familiar because it is the Lamborghini Countach car that I race on an online program, right? I love these racing cars. So I heard it. I'm like, wait, I'm not playing that game. And then here comes a Lamborghini pulling up, and the sound is incredible. It's 12 cylinders. And so it went really slowly because it had this much of a lip from the street to the parking lot, and you had to go real slow to get up and over it, and then he parked. Now, the car is a deep purple color, but wherever the sun shines on the edges, it shines in a seafoam green color. I have no idea how they did this, right? It's awesome, the deep blue and then this bright kind of seafoam green, and then both doors open up, right? Boink. And the guy climbs out. He's in just regular athletic. He was just working out. I think he works or plays for the Oakland Raiders back when they were, anyway. So he got out and also went into Wells Fargo. And I don't know what it is about Lamborghini owners. They leave the doors open. I mean, is there no storage inside? I mean, maybe there's, you can't keep anything in there. Maybe it doesn't have air conditioning. I don't know. Anyway, so the doors are open. Park right next to this Porsche. And so then out comes the poor Porsche owner. He's like, ah, da, da. And you can see him look at the Lamborghini. Mm-hmm. His head dropped, his shoulders slouched, and he walked over to his car, and I swear the chirp was sad. Chirp, chirp. And he got in and drove away. Envy. Envy. Someone will always have a nicer car than you. Someone will have three nicer cars than you. We have some folks that have some really nice cars here. None of them compare to what is in Jay Leno's garage. None of them, right? Can't. And Jay Leno has a garage full of beautiful cars. Doesn't compare to what others own, right? Someone will always have a nicer car. Are you watching with like me as you head south on Gulf of Mexico Drive and you go across along the New Pass Bridge? And you head on to Lido, and then the street bends. Are you watching what's happening at the houses that are on the southern side or eastern side of Gulf of Mexico Drive? That one went down, and they built up a much bigger one. The one next to it went down. They're now building. I just wonder. I mean, who knows? I don't know if that's envy. I don't know if it's just new owners coming in. But it has an effect on us. It happens to pastors, too. There is a church nearby, a church in Sarasota. They have a beautiful music program. Their music budget is larger than all of All Angels' entire budget. Yeah, it's easy to be envious of that. But it is what it is. Episcopal clergy are all envious of how Bishop Curry preaches. He is a fantastic preacher. He's our presiding bishop. He's the one that preached at the royal wedding several years ago in England. He preached about love. Remember that? Yeah, all of us the clergy are like, oh, that's great. And like, oh, I could never do that, right? It has that dual effect. Bishop Curry talks about how he can never preach as good as Bishop Tutu, right? Yet today, if Jesus were to walk in here and to preach to you all, Bishop Tutu couldn't hold a candle to what Jesus would say. And so in our gospel lesson, we have Jesus as a roving traveler. He's going to various synagogues, and he arrives at this one synagogue, and he's preaching. And I can't help but to feel sorry for that synagogue leader, right? Imagine having Jesus preach in your church. Imagine the envy, right? Even though it's Jesus, imagine the envy boiling up. Remember the bumper sticker, my son is God, right? That this, it would be incredible. And then he sees a woman who's been bent over for 18 long years. It might be metaphorical, it might be literal, I don't know. Because bent over, both in Greek and in Hebrew, bent over as a sense of humility, but also a sense of being burdened. And so it could be physically bent over, it could be mentally. She is just worn out. But if you go back into Jesus' day in that synagogue with all the donkeys parked out front, with one with the gold wings open, you know, so all the donkeys out front, everybody from the whole town gathered inside the synagogue. The men sit up here, okay? The men are up front, and the business owners and the wealthy and all that are here, and then it moves back to the peasantry, and then it starts over again with the women who are sitting further back from that. And then those who are handicapped are in the far back reaches, hardly seen in the synagogue. And yet Jesus sees her. And he says to her, "Woman, you are set free from your ailment." When he laid hands on her, immediately she stood up straight and began praising God. Out of all the people that Jesus could see, the woman who was bent over, right? Almost unseeable. Jesus calls her forward. Now, I feel sorry for the synagogue leader. He knows that woman. We'll call her Sarah. "Yeah, I've known Sarah for 18 years. She's had this. We've prayed. She's on our prayer list. Nothing ever happens." And then this guy walks in out of nowhere, and on a Saturday, he just goes ahead and heals her, right? I can see the envy building up. And so then he says to him, "There are 6 days on which work ought to be done. Come on those days and be cured, not on the Sabbath." Yeah, envy. Jesus said, "You hypocrites." This is used in anti-Semitic literature, this phrase right here. Anti-Semites don't recognize that Jesus is Jewish. And so when he says, "You hypocrites," he's talking to his own people, his own religion, the people he identifies with. He's talking to his people. "You hypocrites, don't you also have things at home that you take care of? You take care of them on Sabbath. This is what I do. You do what you do." And then there was shame, according to Luke, and then everybody celebrated. And so, again, envy is at the core of this gospel message. So what can we do to break free from it? Biblically speaking, there are several things we can do, but the first one happens to be in Psalm 103. So if you were to look at Psalm 103, page 3 in your bulletin, the first two stanzas, "Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, bless his holy name." The first thing, the antidote to envy, is giving thanks to God with all that is in you. "Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, bless his holy name." If you feel the strong power and pull of envy, if you can memorize this psalm, just the beginning, "Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, bless his holy name." And the second line, "Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits." All that is within me, and forget not all that God has blessed me with. "Bless the Lord, O my soul." That breaks us free from the power of envy. To go a couple steps further, if we look at Isaiah, the first sentence or two of our Isaiah reading. "If you remove the yoke from those among you, the finger pointing, the wicked speech." Finger pointing and wicked speech has a lot to do with envy. "If you open your heart to those who are hungry and provide abundantly for those who are afflicted, your light will shine." Give thanks and give gratitude. This is the way that Scripture has given us, our source, to go back and to defeat the power of envy. "Bless the Lord, O my soul, all that is within me, bless the Lord. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that God has done, is doing, will do for me. And then generosity, helping others in need. Teddy, my friend, formed a group of moms who have gone through death of their children. She made a support group and opened up to them saying, I can't handle this. This burden is way too heavy for me to carry, for me to hold. And they taught her to say, bless the Lord, O my soul. And for those that have met Teddy, she recently passed away, but she is one of the most thankful people I've ever met. And that she has embraced the thankfulness and helping other women and other men who have been through tragedy, helping widows and widowers to give thanks, and then to open in generosity, to go help in a shelter that has children in it, to go help with those who are victim of domestic abuse, to help, to be generous. And as Isaiah says, to open your heart to those who are hungry and provide abundantly for those who are afflicted. By doing these things, we can easily overcome the power of envy. So bless the Lord, O my soul. All that is within me, bless his holy name. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. And now turning your bulletin to page 4, I invite you to stand as you're able. And together, let us say the words of our faith found in the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father.
Through him all things are made. For us and for our salvation, he came out from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified and washed his fire. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day,
the world to come. Amen.
By the power of the Holy Spirit, let us pray to God, making intercession for the church, the world, and for all people according to their need. Almighty God, thank you for the beauty of earth, sea, and sky. Thank you for blessings without number, and for all who have followed you in faith. Increase our faith and gratitude, and give us joy amidst suffering and comfort in sadness. Give us the courage to invite friends and neighbors into a closer walk with you. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Keep this country in your care. Guide our leaders in paths of righteousness. Help us to preserve and extend the blessings of liberty and justice for all. Send your spirit abroad in the world so that people in every land may learn to do good, seek justice, help the oppressed, defend the orphan, plead for the widow. Help us to find our treasure not in possessions and power, but in faith towards you and in fervent love towards one another. Bring your spirit and peace to Ukraine. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Be the strength and shield of all who risk their life in defense of others. Help them act with wisdom and integrity. When their work is done, let their homecomings be joyful, their bodies and minds be healed and refreshed, their service be honored, and their skills be used in new ways. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Hear the prayers of those who ask for healing and those who seek comfort. We especially remember before you Downs IV, Holden, Brian, Tyler, Barbara, and Ann. Grant healing and recovery for Terry Cobb as he recovers from surgery. Peg, Sandy, Dave, and Mary Jo. Give peace and strength for those going through cancer treatments, especially Jane, Downs III, Victoria, Alex, Connie, and Douglas. Visit and comfort all who are under the care of skilled nursing, especially Timothy, Barbara, Kim, and Mary Ann. Be near to all who are in hospice care, especially Beverly Sinclair. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord Jesus, we thank you for breathing your eternal life into all who have died, trusting in you, especially for those we name now. Give each of us the daily bread we need. Help us to ask for and to give forgiveness. Strengthen us when we are tempted to turn aside from your good will, and deliver us from the snares of the evil one. Bring us into the kingdom that you have prepared for all whom you have redeemed through the merits of your dear Son, so that in the power of the Holy Spirit, we may praise, adore, and bless you forever. Amen. We pray to you also for the forgiveness of our sins. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father. In your compassion, forgive us our sins, known and unknown, things done and left undone. And so uphold us by your Spirit that we may live and serve you in newness of life to the honor and glory of your name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, "Peace I give to you, my own peace I leave with you." Regard not our sins, but the faith of your church, and give to us the peace and unity of that heavenly city, where with the Father and the Holy Spirit you live and reign, now and forever. Amen. Amen. So please stand as you're able. The peace of the Lord be always with you. So please be seated. Are there any birthdays or anniversaries this week? Anybody with a birthday or anniversary? Hi, Debbie. Do you want to come forward? All right. Excellent. It's all right. You can come up anytime.
It was 2 weeks ago, right. But I'm still celebrating.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah. Did your mom have a bumper sticker that said, "My daughter is an attorney"?
No, but she gave me a couple of trophies.
Okay, good. Excellent. Hello.
Hello.
What brings you up here today?
Well, it was my birthday 2 weeks ago, and I'm still celebrating.
Good. You should.
It was a really big one. Don't ask me.
38.
Don't ask. I'd rather tell you how much I weigh than tell you how old I am.
But you're up here celebrating.
Yes,
wonderful.
I'm still celebrating. It's been the greatest month. I've had all these wonderful friends who are celebrating with me and giving me parties and taking
awesome.
Me to lunch. And
good.
I started playing tennis.
Hey.
I'm killing it.
Yes, you are. That's fantastic. Very good. All right, so can I have your hands? Let us pray. Loving God, we thank you for this, your servant. We thank you for the anniversary of her birth. We thank you that joy and love is abounding from her, and you're connecting her with all the people around her who love her so deeply. We ask and give you thanks that you bless her this day. 2 weeks ago on the anniversary of her birth and all the days of her life. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Happy birthday. Hello. How are you?
I'm all right. Today is my wedding anniversary. And a year and a half, Reverend Marshall did an intimate service for my husband, who died, and I've never forgotten that. It meant so much to me. And so I live in Illinois and Florida, but heading towards Florida. So I don't envy anyone. I do need help with peace and nervousness sometime. And this is my beloved best friend who lost her husband in April this year.
Thank you. All right, can I have your hand? And can I have your hand too? For all who have loved and lost, put your hands together and let us pray. Jesus, you promised the Holy Spirit to come upon all who grieve. We are holding you to that promise now, that you bring your comfort and peace to all who have loved and have said goodbye to their loved ones. We thank you for David. We thank you for his life. We thank you that today is the anniversary of their celebration and for all the good things that you have done. We ask he continue to bless Carolyn and all who grieve and bring them your peace. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Today's Ginger's birthday.
Today's Ginger's birthday.
Yes.
Oh my gosh. If you all turn around and wave at the camera. Hi, Ginger. Happy birthday. Gingership is in Illinois. And happy birthday. Wonderful. May God bless you, watch over you, and surround you, and continue to guard you in peace. Amen. All right. Any other birthdays or anniversaries? Very good. I have some things to hand out. All right. So these are name tags. So, Ryan Davis, congratulations. Here's your name tag. And I happen to have one for Natalie Davis. Congratulations. Here's your name tag. Thank you. And, don't you normally sit over here? Okay. Hi, Kate. Here's your name tag. Congratulations. Okay. And who else do we have in here? Oh, you guys are making me run today. Mackenzie. All the way over here. Here's your name tag. Yes, and welcome to the choir. Excellent. So if you have lost your name tag, if you would like a new one, we have a sign-up sheet in the back for name tags. So welcome. Glad that you have them. And if you lose them, we can get you new ones. So that's so wonderful. The discussion group article this week is on the gallery table, and it's discussion about the use of the rosary. It leads into a larger discussion about religious symbols and how one should use them, but it goes deeper than that. And so it's available for you to read, and the discussion group is on Tuesday and on Wednesday. Men's group at 10 o'clock on Tuesday, and 10 a.m. on Wednesday for the women's discussion group. So the coffee is ready for those in person, and then we also have them online. We have Cynthia. You moved. Welcome. Thank you for being here. And we'll have you next week, too. So that's wonderful. Thank you for being here. And choir, summer, awesome. August, I'm very much appreciative that you all are here and singing and raising a loud and happy voice. That is wonderful. Are there any? Oh, Katsy, did you want to introduce George to everybody?
Hello, this is our son, George. I think a lot of you already know him. George lives in Massachusetts, but he's terribly addicted to the beach, so as you can see. So he's come down here, and he's a huge help to us. So
that's awesome.
We're enjoying having
him. Well, welcome. Good to have you. Welcome back, travelers. Thank you. Glad you made it back safely. Good. Speaking of travelers, I keep getting texts from Ben and Jerry, the cats that happen to be that let that let their two owners drive them around the country. I don't know how to share pictures on texts with you. They're awesome. The last one was, I think, correct me if I'm wrong, but I believe it was Jerry taking up the passenger seat, the shotgun seat, if you will, and didn't let it up, didn't want anybody to sit there. So Laurel and Jeff, the cat was going to sleep there. Anyway, so all the rest that are traveling and those who are heading out, may God bless you and look forward to when we all return together. So for communion today, we will have two stations. So Reverend Maggie and myself, we will have the bread and we'll stand here. And then we'll have a chalice on this side and on that side like we did last week. And so if you'd like to receive the bread, put your hands like this. You will be offered the bread. And then if you would like the wine, bring your wafer to them. They will take the wafer from you. They will dip it in the chalice and they will hand it back to you. If you would prefer just to receive bread alone, that is fine. We cannot divide the body of Christ. You receive in one, receive in both. If you'd prefer to have a blessing, just put your arms together like this, and you will receive a blessing. If you are unable to make it up to the altar today, let one of our ushers know, and we will bring communion to you. And speaking of communion, we have Joan and Scott who are with us today. Yay. Normally they're online. Welcome. I'm especially excited about serving you all communion today, so because you're with us spiritually every week, and now we get to do it in person. So let us walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself as an offering and a sacrifice to God.
Lord,
The Lord be with you.
And also
lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. For by water and the Holy Spirit you have made us a new people in Jesus Christ our Lord, to show forth your glory in all the world. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Gracious Father, in your infinite love you made us for yourself, and when we had fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, you in your mercy sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also, that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Alleluia. Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us. Therefore, let us keep the feast. Alleluia. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Turning in your in your bulletin to page 8. Together, let us pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. And you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. The peace of God which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and the love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. And the blessings of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you this day and all those you love forevermore. Amen.